This
Question.
conference will now be recorded. This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, now good morning all of you. So today's first topic is the girl child. Okay, and as you know, some of you are already aware, yesterday being the International Year of the Girl Child, so it's most relevant for our present days. So what about the girl child? Let us see. We all know the women are the pillars of the future. They're the change makers and multitaskers. Actually, you can see the creators of inclusive spaces. The girls of today are proving themselves equal to boys in every aspect, or even better. And they distinguish themselves as the achievers in every field, academics, sports, profession, all professions. And they're successfully playing multiple roles, as you can see, both at and at offices. So it's very relevant to learn some points about the as you know, the achieving gender equality and empowering women is one of the important targets of the Millennium Developmental Goals. You know, United Nations again, developmental goals. These are 8 developmental goals on your left. You can see the third one, promote gender equality and empowering power, is one of the number 3 MDGs, or Millennium Developmental Goals of the United Nations. Many efforts are being made both national and international levels. So initial starting your topic with quoting the Millennium Development Goals will give you a theme of it. Actually, even the examinations also, you just say it is one of the, you need not remember all the goals, at least one of the important goals of the Millennium Development Goals is achieving gender equality. Now, as I already told you, yesterday, October 11th, is International Day of the Girl Child. And this year, the motto is My Voice, Our Equal Future. That is that every year they give one motto. So this is the latest motto of this. The world will be a better place to live the day when girl child is as happy as other gender. Let us work for the synergy to make this dream come true. So happy International Day of the Girl Child 2020. So what is the purpose of this girl child? So every year, 11th October, the International Day of the Girl Child, UNICEF launches it as an annual campaign. It focuses on the demands of the life free from gender-based violence, harmful practices, HIV and AIDS, learn new skills towards the future as they choose, and let women lead the generation of activists accelerating the social change. In India, I also heard the National Girl Child is celebrated on January 24th. But this is internationally, because even Children's Day also is different actually. Internationally, Children's Day is celebrated on October 24th. In India, we do Children's Day on November 14th because of Chacha Nehru's birthday. So some subtle differences may be there. But the International Day is followed most of the places actually. Now, why should we do actually? Why are the concern for all this about the girl child and all these things? The opportunity to bond, opportunity to grow in a safe and secure environment, opportunity to develop one's full potentials. These are the common major issues concerning them. So now when these opportunities are questioned, that is the problem actually. That is the time when we have to give some special attention to this. So if you look at the human developmental indices, these are very, very latest one and standard one. If you want to actually take a screenshot, or actually you can download later on. So these data figures are as up to date as possible, accurate. So all of you know the population of India in crores, actually the total is 121 crores. Savaso crore, our prime minister keeps on saving. So 121 crores, as for the 2011, now it might have crossed even 130 also. So as for the census of 2011, it was 121 crores, or out of which the 62.3 crores are boys and 58.7 crores are females. That is 51 or 52% versus 48%. So that is a break even. Whereas coming to 2018, actually these are the NFHS figures actually, because we have not conducted census again. So the latest being 1.35 millions are 135 crores. So the sex ratio, this is a very, very important aspect, actually. So we will talk more about the sex ratio. 924 males per 1,000 females. That is the main. 924 females per 1,000 males. This is the main problem, area of concern. So the female population is falling down. We'll see more about the population, this ratio later. Literacy rates, as seventh class or above, the boys are 82% and 65% only. This is in 2011. Actually, the situation is not much better now. But even then, out of total literacy is 74% only, being above seventh class. So this is the gross differences, actually. This is slowly catching up, but at that time, that is the main problem. Now, maternal mortality is still 122 in 2011. Infant mortality, as latest figures of 2017, total infant mortality in India is 33, and there may be a little urban is better than the rural. Female mortality is marginally more, 32 versus 34. Sorry. Sorry. So under 5 mortality rate is a little marginally more boys than females. Life expectancy at birth, 71 for males, 68 for females. Adult literacy rate, this figure 78 versus 59 is now much, much better actually. There is 15th class or above 15 years children. Now latest one, ladies and girls are actually catching up. So these are from the sample registration system of the Office of Registrar and National Family Health Survey, NFHS 15 and 16. So what is the most important alarming thing is female to male ratio. This is the most dangerous figure actually we have. Sex ratio, we are talking about that actually now. It's defined as the number of females per actually 1,000 males, not 100, sorry. Should be 1,000. In some states, it is even as low as the 800, whereas in Kerala, it is almost same. So the adverse sex ratio, what happens is it creates a shortage of women and severe long-term implications. We'll see later on. So this should not be there actually. This adverse sex ratio is very dangerous in various aspects. You can see here, actually the worst, it is very bad in 2013, the national level section, 900 for 1,000 boys in 2013. As we approach 2018, it is a little improving actually. As you can see, by 2018, it has reached 2016. And state-wise also, this is from the Enadu paper actually, you can see. Each state has given different ratios, and you can see Arunachal Pradesh have very good positive ratio because more females than the males. The worst in Gujarat and some other Bihar, I think this one is a very bad thing, 899. So where are we? Andhra Pradesh, we have got 935 females for only 1,000. So we are somewhere in the middle. As for the this is Punjab is very bad actually. Punjab is a very, very dangerous one. Very little. So this is a very adverse sex ratio. This has to change. So what are the discrimination? Why is it? What is happening? Because we can categorize them into various aspects. Like one is the female infanticide, disparity in the rearing, the childhood marriages, and various atrocities and women, where we are just like in honor killings, dowry system, genital mutilations, we'll see each one actually. So many disparities that is actually happening. Talking about the female infanticide. So female sex determination and sex selective abortion, because if it is a female fetus, they want to remove the fetus. This is actually medical profession, unfortunately. Our own profession is helping them. This was noticed. Why is it happening? why actually parents are asking for this. These parents only bring it actually. So various social phenomena like the dowry. If there's a girl, they have to give you a lot of dowry. And anyhow, what is the purpose of having a girl? Girl is going away. It's a parayadhan. We are not having any use for it because whatever those we have to do is go to some other house and job. Problem related to safety and marriages. Actually, these have to keeping the child safe is very dangerous and marrying up very problematic. And moksha, one thing, you know, son only because without son is there and they can like take that after death, otherwise they won't go moksha. And most of the communities, it is like this is a problem, unbelief actually. And we are living in a patrilineal society because the, most of the property, unless the son is there, property will go to somebody else actually. So in that the patriarchal society, what happens? They must have a son, irrespective of whatever it is. So these are the, some of the things. That's why they promote male child and they want, they do not want female child. These are the things. This wedding expense, they have to bear the dowry, wedding expenses, customs of gift giving, inability of the girl to take care of the family. Because when they become old, at least they believe, at least the son is there, they will look after. Of course, they are not doing that these days. But anyway, there's a belief. Girl is there, they cannot go to the girl's house and they cannot spend. Domestic violence, various, this is ill treatment by husbands and in-laws, that they have to bear all these things. Ill treatment on account of giving birth to a girl. And so on. The mother-in-law scolds you. Actually, they can't produce a male child at all like that. So these are all the things making that female feticide very prevalent in this thing. So all this go hand in hand with the child discrimination. I'm talking about the discrimination because the girls are looked up differently than men. So what are the discriminations? So what are the disparity in rearing? Next point is the disparity in rearing. Globally, if you talk about the nutrition and education, we'll take two topics. One is the nutrition. One third of the deaths of children under 5 are attributed to malnutrition. That is irrespective of both sexes together. Of these girls, nutritional intake is relatively inferior because they first give the male child what is remaining to the female child quality because he did not have to go out actually. Why do you require more? All these things of the attitudes of the parents. And women expend greater deal of energy inside than outside. So whereas they often have insufficient food. That has happened actually because the boy is going out and he is doing work, actually let him have more food like that. The mother itself says that. So these are the problems actually. Children are not malnourished. Female children get more malnourished. Speaking of education, 3-7% of children between 6 and 10 years and 5.2% of group in between 11 and 13 years early dropouts. Why they are dropping out? Actually, why they are dropping out? There are various purposes actually are there. So the dropping out rate is school had to be, some are actually never attended school at all. And enrollment of school ratio, because in 2001 it was 77, but now actually it is very, very nearly crossing 90% now in the females. Why? The reason is they have to do the household work, because who will do household work if the girl goes? The school is so distant, the girl cannot walk. There is a low female teacher, especially the higher forms, unless the female teacher is there, the parents are worried, actually not safety of the girls. There is no toilet at all, because suppose in the middle they want to go, right, they are too far off, actually, there is no proper toilet at all. How can we send the girls to this thing? These are all the factors. Whatever the factors is there, all these have to be attended. Somehow the school enrollment has fallen down. Now, various other forms of gender discrimination, you see, because the fewer months of breastfeeding, below par medical care, insufficient nutrition, already I told you, the lack of prenatal, natal, and postnatal care results being more susceptible to pregnancy. Because if their proper care is not there, it may actually pregnancy time they get more diseases, poor health, and that leads to shorter lifespan. They die early. Women employees also, even in the workplace also, women place a lot of disparities, right? The workload or actually work during timings of hours, and they have the providing of the facilities like toilets and actually privacy areas. No inclusion in the decision-making process. It's a boy, I said patriarchal society. What the father says, it is final actually. I have to say, you have to marry off and finish off. So they do not give at all importance to the girl. So that is the problem with the patriarchal society system. Women are still deprived of the rights of ancestral property. Except in Kerala, Nair's community, most of the other communities are patriarchal. The father's property goes only to the male children, not to the female children. That itself is a social remit, very, very disease that will lead to the disparity to the females. Now the question of child marriages. So it is illegal to marriage in India. It's 18 years actually. 18 years of age. However, 36 point of marry before the attaining of the 18 years of age. So before 18 years, they should not be, but unfortunately, even 10, 20 years also children are married. This is, it violates human rights. And what are the consequences? Because child loses his opportunity of childhood. You are robbing the child of the childhood. So she cannot go to education. The sexual exploitation right from the 10, 15 years, as soon as they become maturity, they get pregnant, actually they lose all the problem. The violence and early pregnancy associated problems are all these things are the secondary to the child marriage. It's very, very dangerous. Now atrocities on the third aspect, the fourth aspect is atrocities. These atrocities are various types of atrocities. Trafficking is very dangerous because purposely the children are being abducted and they put into various brothel houses, and actually their money earning mechanisms. Like right from the childhood itself, they are being reared in such houses, and there is a big, the tools of exploitation. This is called the third largest crime in the world. 79% of global traffic is because of the sexual exploitation. And sexual harassment, though this is not an organized crime, but still harassment is a day-to-day crime. Every girl, actually every 7 minutes, a crime is committed against women, and almost all the women at some stage are they are facing, right? From because of a simple comment on the outside while they're going, or to the extent of getting raped and even killed. Even yesterday also, the news today, you see, the morning by Bihar, one girl is with child and mother, they were they abused and they actually thrown out the canal. So this type of, we see horrible houses, this thing, this news almost every day it has become. Then female genital mutilation. So these tribal areas in India, actually especially in Africa, is very, very common. At least 130 million girls alive today have they undergone some sort of genital mutilation, because this is actually, they say, it is like circumcision done for a female. So they remove most of the external genitalia so that the female will not have the sexual feelings, and actually they live, they are only for the only procurement, the reproduction only. So until marriage, they shall not get any sexual feelings or like that. Maintain the purity, so-called purity, they say. That's actually against her will, against the human nature at all. There's 2 million more are at risk every year, because the girls, as soon as they reach a maturity area, they do this, that is genital mutilation. Very, very heinous practice, actually. So what can we do? So a determined drive to make the general public aware about the importance of bringing a girl child and giving her equal rights. This is most important, is equal rights. Stringent measures to curb selective abortions, especially the dowry deaths and all the that is social evils like dowry. Being a parent, one should, especially there is a social remedy, because the parents themselves did differentiate them. That should not be there. They should treat one's kids equally. So right from the beginning, that equality, they should right from the childhood. So whether it is a health or education, whatever it is, a little amount of care, a handful of warm, a heartful of love for a girl child can make a lot of difference. So we have got a lot of legislation. Is it something not being done? Yes, done. Because at the national level, some of the example, 2003, actually it's the 1994 itself is formulated, but 2003, the modification, there's a PNDT Act. All of you are familiar, actually, especially medical profession. So that is a Preconception and Prenatal Diagnostic Techniques Act. What is the intention is to prohibit the prenatal diagnosis. Now, any pregnant woman cannot go and ask the checks of the child, actually. If somebody, the ultrasound machines, whoever is having a machine of ultrasound which he can determine the size, they cannot do it without proper record keeping, and they should not give the sex of the baby to the parents at all. If at all, if they are given, they are liable to be punished, actually, they are penalized. So once the parents do not know what is the sex, there is no question of female fetus. Actually, if they know it is a female, okay, I don't want this child, please remove, they go to the gynecologist, and actually somebody say, if the other way, they themselves try actually with a abortion, leading to septic abortions and all these things. So they do not know until the suspense, only at the time of death they will know if the boy or girl, actually they should know at the time of delivery, not before at all. So that is one of the very, very significant, right? Even the ultrasound machines, everyone they scan, actually they have the severe scanning, for their activities, not for the ultrasound they are doing. The sound machine, the institute themselves are under scan by the authorities. Second, recently, with 2012, the POCSO Act. The POCSO Act is protection of children from sexual offences because the Act incorporates child-friendly procedures over the reporting, recording evidence, investigations, and trial of offences. Actually, noting the FIR, if at all committed any heinous activities committed, the POCSO Act has a very, very stringent role. The punishments are also very severe, non-bailable offences. Now, the Criminal Law Amendment Act, all of you know the Nirbhaya Act, it is popularly known as after the horrific incident of 2012, December. So 2013, the Nirbhaya Act has come. So it lays down the stringent punishment to deal with the sexual crimes. Actually, the definition of rape on itself is changed, actually. Even the molesting has actually become the number rape. And I don't know, so that it acts as a deterrent, that is at least hope, but still it's not doing actually that. And all of you know the unfortunate incident last year, after the Disha incident, the Andhra Pradesh government has done the Disha Act, actually. Here it provides awarding death sentence for offense of rape and gang rape, expediting that expedited verdict, because always what is happening, what is, you have seen the Nirbhaya case itself. After so many years, to hang those children, even after conviction is done, actually, indiction is done, we cannot do the hang, because so many loopholes in the legal procedures actually took such a, but at least justice delayed, is denied, they used to say, but they were done. But in this case, some of the times, because they burned the poor lady, we cannot get evidence also. This Nirbhaya, she was there to give at least the statement. Here in this case, the victim is no longer there. So with all whatever evidence you produce will be hearsay. So whether it is good or not, actually the police have actually proactively and all the suspect were killed, that's a different thing, but whether it is killed, legally is acceptable or not, we do not know. But anyway, the legal methods, to introduce legal methods, Disha Act has been introduced. These are all for the good of the society. And there are so many national programs for it. These are actually the legalization. Apart from the legalization, the programs, actually, there is a big list of programs are there. These are not all for the undergraduates. You just remember three or four, actually. I'll just mention those one, actually, note down that one. So, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. The Prime Minister has introduced, that is a BBBP. Like that. Kishori Shakti Yojana, the second one. And the CBSE, you know, Central Bureau of Education, the CBSE Udan scheme is there actually. So like the Sabala scheme. Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. So at least three or four, you remember. And these are state-wise, different states have produced various schemes are there. Don't bother about all those things, just do Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. This is the logo of this scheme. Excuse me. So this is the logo of the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, central government scheme for the girl child schemes, which is applicable throughout the country. The key objective of this scheme is to save the girl child from social ills such as gender biased abortions, to advance the education of the girl child all over, to prevent gender biased selective abortions, ensuring survival and protection of the child, ensuring education and the participation of the girl child in the community. All these aims that we already mentioned. So just remember at least gender equality and equal education like this. So remember the name, that is very important. And Kishori Shakti Yojana is, this is not necessary, we'll go with this one. The CBSE Udan scheme. Actually, this free course material or online resources given for the material supply of the girl students of the 11th and 12th standard. This promote the education. So there are weekend classes are conducted for this. Peer learning mentioning, study helpline services to clarify their doubts, constant monitoring and tracking of the students. This is by the CBSE, Central Board of Secondary Education is there. So Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. This is also important, just mention this one also. This provide compensation for wage loss in terms of cash incentives so that women can take advantage of the rest before and after delivery. This is for the pregnant woman, especially expected women. So they give cash, nearly incentive of cash, nearly of 1,000 rupees provided by Janani Suraksha Yojana, JSY Institution Delivery. So this is for the grown-up women at least. So these are the some of the things, and all these things may not be necessary. I'll just skip them off. So what else we can do? So there are strict rules are allowed for the especially PNDT, female PET set. Doctors should themselves be conscious about it. They should not do. And if somebody, anybody violates, or punishment should be given, death, if any of the parents actually, this is stringent, even for the death penalty, for actually penalty. Protecting the girl child should be one of the top priorities of the government. Strict implementation of the existing welfare scheme. There are so many schemes I mentioned actually, but how they are implemented, that is important. And implementation of the prevailing laws. There are laws, but what use if they are not implemented, they are not much of use. So these are the things to be ensured. So ensure that the schemes are being done well, the promotion schemes, and ensure that the laws are being implemented. And there are non-governmental organizations are also there. For example, DASRA 99 is a catalyst in social change, especially for the female child. This non-governmental organization, Save the Child organization, they started in 2008. This is an international organization in India. They are doing so much of work for the female child development. Child Rights and You, CRY. This is the logo of the child. They also produce various books and actually promote so many schemes for the female child development. So all these work towards development of the girls and their education, health and sanitation, especially different fields. So these voluntary organizations are also doing several. So that's the end of it. Thank you. That is about the female child. Okay. So we have completed the first half of this chapter. And supposed to conduct the second lecture of today is child labor, something related to this actually. So we are talking about the child labor. So in this, we are going to do what is meant by child labor. So what are some statistics, categories of child labor, the basic reasons why the child labor, and what happens because of the child labor, and various some factors and statistics again. What are the labor laws available in India? So the introduction, who is a child? The Child Labor Prohibition Regulation Act of 1986 defines a child as a person who has not completed 14 years actually. So as per this act, 1986 law, it is a 14 years old. But actually WHO and adolescent is also up to 18 years, all of you know. So child labor is by definition employment of children in any work that deprives children of childhood, interferes with the ability to attend regular school, and it is mentally, physically, socially, and morally dangerous and harmful. So this is just like your preventive medicine definitions. So that means what you understand is anything, any activity which is depriving the child of the childhood is a child labor. Now, how common is this? There is a global estimate, 152 million children across the world. So they are actually, and out of these, 64 million are girls and 88 million are boys in child labor globally, accounting for 1 in 10, almost every 1 in 10 child in the labor field. Out of the 71% of children child labor work in a agricultural sector, 69% unpaid work within their own family unit, because they are working for the family, no? They can't even ask for a wage. Children in labor force, according to International Labor Organization 2017, they accounted about 4.3 million. Situation in India, as per the 2011 census, more than 10.2 million are economically active children in the age group of 14 years, and out of these, 5.6 are boys, 4.5 million are girls. One in every 11, actually in the international, one in 10, India, one in 11, India works for earn for living. 8 million children are working in rural, 2 million in the urban area. This is according to the research kit publication of this one. So all these figures I have been giving are latest corrected. So most authenticated, you can take the references also with this actually. Look at this situation actually. If you see statewide also across the country, right through the night from the 1991 to 2011, you see It used to be very high, gradually coming down. So the other Nagar Haveli is the central government, there is union territories, Andaman Nicobar. There, the comparatively, the labor force is less, but all other states, Andhra Pradesh is here actually, about 5 million in the year 2011. So compared to 2001 and 2009, it has come down actually from that, all these areas, but not significantly has come down. 2011 also still there is a nearly between 5 and 10 means at least 7 million, it is 4.8 million or something like in Andhra. So there are several categories of the child labor, be it in shops or small scale vendors, carpet making, lock making, brassware, export oriented garments, gem polishing, leathers, diamonds, etc. More dangerous in the labor, furnaces, welding, hazardous materials, and the worst is a slavery, that is a trafficking of children, bonded labor, serfdom. These are very dangerous things actually. So look at this. This is a category in domestic labor. All of you may be familiar with so many areas we see in small children actually. Categories of child labor in the working, helping in the shop or actually whatever the business of the father or mother or whatever, maybe family business. But there they can't go to school, they are locked up here because everybody else, their father is somewhere else. Okay. This primary tradition actually is a cloth making, carpet making, whatever it is, if the father is doing that, they are keeping and helping like this. Brick making, there's various types of provision actually. They are not supposed to do that. That time child has to go to the school, but what is he doing here? And more dangerous, there are mines also, in working in this coal mine. So like that, as the father is breaking the coal, the child is also breaking his coal actually. What is he doing here? The dangers for his health and his future. And the worst form, as I said, the bonded labor. What happens here is somebody, the father or grandfather, has taken a loan as it is, he cannot replace the interest actually. They are supposed to work for generations together for that, the jamindar or whoever it is. So like that, just because of no fault of them, the generation is, he has to work, his son has to work, his daughter has to work. I know this, the bonded labor is the worst kind of labor. Whatever work they have to do, they are told they are supposed to do, is the bad thing. So why is the child labor is coming? Poverty, lack of education resources. He has not studied at all. He cannot get any other job. They have to do the bloody things. Social and economic backwardness push them to this type of menial black jobs. Addiction, disease, and disability. Because the father is addicted to alcohol, whatever it is, because he doesn't earn, because somebody has to earn. Disease, or his father is ill, actually not able to do, disability. Parents are not doing, the child has to work along on par with them. The lure were cheap labor, because child can give away half the salary of the adult actually, because the labor, the people are interested in employing younger children. So if he gives half the salary of the adult, it's okay. So that's the widened gap between the rich and the poor, the discrimination between the boys and girls, inefficiency of law, because there's so many laws, again we are going to see, but they are not being implemented, administrative system is poor. So these are all the factors. What happens because of all these things? What are the consequences? The children are impeded in gaining skills or education because he cannot go to school. They are prone for injuries and sexual exploitation, especially girls, and what from there leading to STDs, HIV, and drug addictions and alcoholism, all these things subsequent to the exploitations. Emotional neglect and deprivation of the family love affair, because they lead to a psychological impacts throughout the life they are suffering from this. Missing educational qualification, higher skill. Once there is no higher skills, is hardly first 10th class, we will give a bigger job. We can't even do a clerical job also. So this badges and salaries come down, because the lesser the education, even if somebody wants to give me good salary also, what is it? You don't have qualification, you can just be small salaries and the small jobs. And national level, this deprives the nation of developing higher skill, but the most of the potential is being wasted actually. So their technical capabilities are there, but the nation is not getting them. So child protection, what is child protection is about ensuring the children have a security net that depends upon if they happen to fall through the holes of the system. The system has a responsibility to provide the child with necessary care, rehabilitation, and bring back. This is a social responsibility. Child protection is the social responsibility all of us will have. So there are children, you know, United Nations Child Rights, United Rights of the Child, Convention of the Rights of the Child has shown this, that all children are equal and have the same rights. Every child has a right to have his or her basic needs fulfilled. Every child has the right to protection from abuse and exploitation. Every child has a right to express his or his opinion to be respected. These are the United Nations Rights of the Child. Actually, this is very important. Then, these childs actually can be nutshell making into these four one: right to survival, right to development, right to protection, and right to participation. So these very, very important. Do you remember these four rights actually? What are the human rights? Survival, protection, and participation, development, SPPD. That is the name of it. So these are very, very important. There are so many laws in India also. So we need to see Factories Act 1948 prohibits employment of children below 14 years. Factories are not supposed to, but we have to implement it. That's all. The Mines Act of 1952, it prohibits even under 18 years, they should not be employed at all, especially after health checkup and all these things. Child Labor Act of 1986, National Child Labor Act, it bans employment of children below any in many professions. They have given a big list also. Juvenile Justice Act 2000, it defines a child as being below 18 years. Exactly. So they have extended now in 2000. Child means up to 18 years also here. They cannot be implemented in for the criminal activities about all these things. Actually, if there is activities conducted by below 18 years, they should be treated separately. Rights of the children to free and compulsory education. The 2009 Act is there actually. It ensures all children below between 6 and 14 years have right to free and compulsory education. This is according to this law. So many laws are there. Indian Constitution, our Constitution itself has got so many provisions. So Article 21A says children of all ages 6 to 14 years should be provided with free and compulsory education as per the article itself. Article 45 says state should provide early childhood care and education to all children below the age of 6. Article 51K states parents, guardians of children between the ages of 6 and 14 should provide them with opportunities of education. That is, the onus is on the parents also. So like that, so many protections are. National Commission for Protection of Children, NCPCR, which is a statutory body constituted in 2007 for protection of the child. So this commission mandates to ensure the laws, policies, programs, or administrative mechanisms are consonant with child rights perspective enshrined in the constitution. It looks after the constitutional rights are being clearly been implemented. So NCPCR. So how to tackle this child labor issue is, one is stable economic growth. If the country is economically growing, there is no need for all the children to work at all. Respect the labor standards. We have got labor laws, are there? Respect them. Decent work. Universal education is a very, very important thing. Social protections and recognition of the needs of the rights of the child, because I said four rights of them. Because together, all these help to root the cause of the child labor according to International Labor Organization. So these are voluntary organizations are also there as the Childline India. All of you are familiar, the 101, this is a 1028 is the number, 1098, anytime child in the distress, with whatever it is, child in the labor, we see child labor being not been done, and rules are not been, you can just call this. Those people will come and see, investigate and protect those children who are working in a hazardous kind of situation. So you can directly, anonymously also, you can call and inform if the child is being illegally employed. So thank you very much. So these two are social topics given to me, actually, the social pediatrics. They are quite important, especially they make short notes, may be coming if not in the essay. But the a few statistics that is very, very important on this. So this we stop today's topic. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.